Yeah, absolutely. You know, I'm looking at some of the notes here, guys, that you guys were moving a big reactor earlier this year. We're talking about something that was like 64 feet long, 20 feet wide, 17 feet high, and it weighed 389,000 pounds. And it took many months to plan and execute. And David Davenport, I'm reading here that you were the supervisor on that job. When you got the phone call for that text, David, what were your thoughts about that? Was it like, man, we could do this and let's get to work?
Well, I think to comment on that, and then I'll turn it over to David, Mark. When we get those type of inquiries, the first thing we try to do is assess the full scope of the job and what's going to be, you know, where obviously its origin destination, so that we can start looking at the overall scope of the job and plan that. And obviously with expertise of people like David Davenport, now we go put them in the field to start gathering and putting together that information and working with not only the client but obviously the states and the municipalities and cities that load potentially would be traveling through. David, you want to comment?
Well, having been a driver for part of my own life, when I see something like that come in, the first thing I say is, hey, this looks great. When do we get to start? But obviously, on that particular load, we spent 7 months developing the routes that we would take, and then several site visits, trips back and forth to Billings. On the way, we dealt with two different snowstorms that shut us down.
Mm-hmm.
The last 100 miles, we had to go in the dark, 11 miles of that on a gravel road. And we took down traffic signals and street lights in the city.
Oh, wow.
And it was just a great time.
Yeah, no goodness sakes. And also, to expand on that, if you will, because when you mentioned you were taking down, say, signal lights and, you know, having to maybe route around certain routes and things like that, that requires reaching out to maybe local police or city officials or government leaders or maybe state DOT or state police. There's a lot of collaborative efforts that are utilized in maybe moves like this, right?
Yes, there really were. We made a couple of different visits to the city of Billings, and the police department there was very helpful, as well as all the local utility people, and they were just absolutely great to work with. But that's because you're there and you plan it, not because you show up and they say, oh, no, what are we going to do now?
Yeah. And David and Tex, let me ask you this from a sales perspective and also Tex from, you know, you being the president of the organization. You've got to get every single detail down to the I's dotted, T's crossed. I mean, with something that size, you really can't leave any stone unturned, right? Right, Tex? What do you say to that?
Yeah, no, and to kind of follow up on what David said there, you know, that when you're traveling through multiple states, and it really doesn't, whether you're going across town, Mark, or you're going across the country, it's that planning, it's that communication, it's the, you know, getting those people involved with the move with you, and that on-the-ground planning gets their buy-in, because obviously the number one priority in moving any of this cargo over the, you know, over the road system is the motor public safety. So that is our number one priority, and to maintain a steady traffic flow. So as we go into these particular areas and we're moving a load, that plan is essential that they all buy into it with us, and that they understand what that plan is, so that movement of that cargo flows through there and minimizes any potential congestion that may happen just because of the pure size of the load.
And expand on the – go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, I said all of that goes into it.
All right. And let me ask you this, and David Farabee, let me bring you into the conversation as well, along with Tex. When you look at it from the sales perspective, you've also got to think along the lines, okay, you know, this is going to require maybe a certain amount of technology or maybe some kind of a price structure that goes along with that. How do you look at that from, say, the business aspect of making sure that all of the costs are covered that are associated with this? And David Farabee and Tex, it's open to you both if you want to jump in.
Well, this is a difficult thing sometimes as we have certain variable costs with pilot cars and municipalities, permit costs can vary, so it is very difficult to pin something down. We always start with a load plan that we interact with our customer on, understanding what the correct scope of work is going to be, what the timing is going to be, and it helps us to nail down as best we can what some of these costs will be. Obviously, it depends on the route we're going to travel, but we have great cooperation with the states we run through and them supporting our routing requirements and the things that we have to do. It helps kind of at least give us a ballpark idea of where that may be. Many times utility trucks are involved to move wires, municipality trucks to move street lights. So it is a little bit of a moving target. So the collaboration with the customer is extremely important, and having them buy into our load plan and what actually needs to transpire.
Yeah, and again, like you're mentioning, Tex, this stuff doesn't happen overnight. This takes months and months of planning and strategy meetings to make sure that everybody's on the same page. That includes your drivers, right? How important is the communication process with them as well? Expand on that, if you will.
Well, again, Mark, you know, when you take a load like with the one we're, you know, we're talking in reference here to that spanned over basically 7 months from planning of the load till actual execution of it, and then obviously this particular load, the execution of it was basically at the end of the year 2016, and the movement started in 2017 and spanned through winter months going into, you know, a more difficult area due to weather at that time of year. And like David said earlier, you know, we had two winter storms that we had to deal with. That time obviously is to make sure the team, the whole team, from like David's position, the supervisor that's managing all the on-ground activity, including all the way to the drivers, understands what that scope is, what all that scope entails, and how that's going to be planned out, all the way down to the minute things, Mark, like where you're going to park. Mm-hmm. When you're that big, that heavy, that long, it's the little things that you have to anticipate and plan for, because you never know when they're going to happen.
Yeah.
And so, you know, when we're dealing with that, everybody on the team has to know what that is and what we're going to do when that happens.
And that also includes, Tex, your office personnel, correct? The dispatchers, the logistics planners, things like that. All across the board, this has got to be, everybody's got to be on the same page. Talk about the office personnel and the strengths there.
Well, again, you know, with everybody you've got on the ground, obviously in any successful environment, you have a back office support team that's just as important and is just as trained as well as the people on the ground that are executing the business, because they're providing everything to those people so that the execution of that comes off as it's planned. So they are just as important to the team out on the road. Because if they don't do their job right, guess what? That the team out on the road doesn't get to execute.